All right. Admits. Hi Julia, welkom. All right, Tatjana, welcome to the second webinar. Good to see both of you here. Another Julia, welcome. Cats, welcome. Lots of girls so far. Don't know what the ratio is in my prep course, but I get the idea that there are more girls than boys. I'll wait until for like 4 or 5 minutes. Yeah, I'll wait for 4 minutes to get started, because else I need to start over every single time. But good to see that you're here. This is the dedication you want to see from master students, or in this case, upcoming master students. Like I said Monday, if you take your master this serious, then I'm sure all of you will be masters of science in a year from now, or 2 years, depending on whether you're doing a normal master or a research master. One person left, didn't like me. One person was like, fuck this. I'm not going to do this. I need my vacation. And I can't blame him, or to be honest, everybody deserves a vacation. Another person left. Okay. Welcome, Rose and Linda. And Kat is back. Welcome, everybody, to the second statistics webinar. I'll wait for like 3 more minutes before I start, because some people are entering a bit later. That's not a problem. And then in 3 minutes from now, I'll get started. All right, welcome to the new participants, Fleur and Iliana. Welcome to the second webinar. I'll wait for 2 more minutes and then I'll get started. All right, welcome to the 2 participants which just joined, which I think are Elena and someone else. I'll wait for 1 more minute and then I'll get started. all right, it's now 3 minutes past two. If more people join later, then that's not a problem. Good to see all of you here, 16 participants, which are the diehard core of our prep campus. Welcome to the second webinar. I think most of you were there Monday as well. I hope that all of you have started by now. I took a look and I saw that 21 people have already completed the first test, which I think is a good thing. You should be at that pace. If you've already made test one, that means that you're following the right pace. It means you've completed chapter one and two. If you didn't do the test and you're not going to do the test, then that's fine as well. But I do recommend keeping a certain pace or finishing it in 2 weeks, because my supervision will mostly be throughout these 2 weeks. Then I answer as soon as possible. After these 2 weeks, I still answer, but it might take me a bit longer since it's no priority of me then. And so far, I have to say that you guys haven't been asking a lot of questions, which I assume it can either be a good or a bad thing. It can either be a good thing because the explanations of all the theory is clear, or it can be a bad thing since maybe you're not working on it and that's why you're not asking questions. But I do think that the explanations is quite broad. I've made sure that there is theory, that there are endless examples, endless exercises, and also a YouTube video on top of every page. So I'm not really surprised that there aren't many questions, but I am wondering whether there are going to be questions for this webinar now. I hope so, because else this is going to be world's shortest webinar. So do you guys have any questions currently about statistics or about the VU or about Amsterdam or about housing, about study advisors, anything? Shoot.
Hi, can I just ask my question?
Yeah, that's perfect.
So I'm currently on chapter four and I'm struggling a little bit with the last two theory parts. Well, it's not so much the theory parts, but the calculations that go with it. Okay. So the sampling distribution of the sample mean and the sampling distribution of the sample proportion.
Mm-hmm.
I think I'm struggling a little bit because of the previous calculations could have been done manually, and here it's only partially that they can be done manually. And the part that is that I could try in Excel, it didn't give me any results. Like, even tried the same examples that were given there.
Yeah.
I did put the whole formula, but I just didn't get the number. So maybe if you could show.
So if I'm correct, you're struggling with the Excel part of the assignments.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. And you've been entering it in Excel, and then you didn't get the answers you needed.
Yeah, I just put in the formula like was in the example, the same numbers, and I didn't get the result.
Yeah. Did you try using a dot instead of a comma at certain points, or a comma instead of a dot? It might be that your Excel is on a different language, and that then it doesn't recognize for example, maybe in the example it's 0.5. Well, you need in Excel, you need to enter 0.5. But I'll see if that I can show you whether it works or not. I'll share my screen with you.
Yeah.
Let's see, where's.
Yeah, especially the formula of the normal and normal distribution.
Okay, you guys can currently see my screen, and I'll take, you said it was the theory part, sampling distribution of the sample mean.
Yes.
Okay. But I don't see a formula in there.
I think there were like three or four examples on the purple dots. So like, for example,
I think I see now a normal distribution. The formula with normal distribution. Yeah, over here it uses commas. It might also be the case that you don't need to add a comma, but an epsilon, which is a dot above a comma. So it might be true. So I'll try it out. If you select a cell in Excel, and then it's important that first you press the is button, so the equal to button. You need to start your formula with this sign, because then SPSS knows that it's a formula you're entering. And in this case, it would be a norm.dist. It already gives the example of a normal point dist, so a normal distribution, so it knows you want to use that. So you can select it, and then you have norm.distribution. And then the x is gonna, and the mean and the standard deviation and the cumulative. Let's say that the x which we have found is 2.5, and then an epsilon in this case. You can in the example it gives a comma, but if you want to use an epsilon, which is this sign, which is a dot above a comma, then the mean is 2.8. Then the standard deviation is 0.3, and the cumulative is always 1, if I'm correct. Let me check that real quick. And if I then press enter, then it should give that there's a problem with the formula. But what is the problem to? Yeah, to be honest, I sometimes struggle with this part as well. I don't think it's handy at all. That's where you, okay, so in this case, I had to use commas to mark decimals. So 2.5 and 2.8 and 0.3. And while separate the different parts, you have to use, in this case, an epsilon instead of the commas. It depends on what language Excel is in. But once you know this, it shouldn't be a problem anymore. So did this answer your question?
Yeah, I think so. Also in the example, when you have this formula, like the normal distribution at the end is true, but the true you don't type in, that's just if it satisfies that it's bigger than 10, right? The test, I don't remember what the phrase was, but one second.
It's true. Yes, you don't have to calculate on the following commands and true. I don't think you actually have to use the true. Most of the times the cumulative is a one. So almost always in this course, it's one. I can try if that makes a difference. Okay, so I've now entered one of the examples, but you can see already that I need to alter it, because this comma needs to be an epsilon. This one needs to be an epsilon. And this one needs to be an epsilon. And then I get the same problem. So it doesn't recognize the true parts, I think. So instead of true, you should enter a one. It's throughout this course. A bit of a squishy explanation, but I hope that it does make sense now.
I will try it out later, and if it doesn't work, then maybe I just text in WhatsApp or
Sure. Okay, I'll give another example. Let's just say let's delete this. Okay, let's just say that there is that throughout the whole population, so throughout the Netherlands, there is that everybody drinks approximately 2 liters of water a day, and the standard deviation is 0.2. And now you've done your own sample research. You've taken 100 students and you've asked them about how many liters of water they drink a day. And it turns out that they drink 2.3 liters of water a day. So the population mean, and in this case, the sample mean is 2.0. The standard deviation is 0.2. And the sample which we have found, so the sample mean, the sample that we found is 2.3. And you want to know if that is a significant difference to the population mean or not. So you start off by entering the is button, then norm.distribution, then open brackets, and then first the sample you found, which in this case was 2.3, then an epsilon. Well, the population mean was 2, the standard deviation was 0.2, and the cumulative is in this case 1. It always is. And then you find that the p-value is in this case 0.933, so it's not a significant difference. Does this make sense to you?
Yeah, I think so.
Okay. Are there any more questions currently? Now is the time to ask you. You may ask them in the chat, or you can ask it like the way I did right now. You can unmute yourself and ask a question.
Hi, Buzz. Hi, everyone.
Hi.
I wanted to ask just a quick question on chapter, wait a second, I think. Okay, it's about percentiles, to be exact. So it's the formula on how to find the location of certain percentile, like, for example, 17th percentile of a distribution is, and the formula which is described in your part is p divided 100. Then multiply n minus 1, and after all this calculation, we add 1, right?
Sorry, I had some issues with Zoom. Which chapter is this again? It's percentiles, so that is...
Yeah, maybe it would be easier to understand if I share my screen.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, okay, let me do this. Oh, okay, so I cannot do it. Okay,
wait only, a second. I think only the host. I don't think I can grant you access to share your screen. I think only the host can do that, sadly.
Yeah, so it's about percentiles. So it's descriptive statistics, frequency distribution, measures of location 1. Yeah, it's frequency distribution number 8 part.
Okay, yeah, I see that. I see that part now. Okay, yes. Let me open this real quick and then I'll share. Mm-hmm. Come on, why doesn't it open? In the meantime, I'll share my screen again. But this time with my. So, okay. Is it this website? Is it this page with percentiles? Mm-hmm. For example, calculate the 20th percentile.
Yep.
Okay. And then what part did you struggle with?
Could you please show the formula?
Which one?
P divided 100, like definition percentiles, and nearby there is a formula.
Okay. I think it's this formula.
Yeah. So in the video, in the YouTube video you referred, there is a formula which is a bit different. So they just multiply p divided 100, they right away multiply on n plus 1 without calculation in the brackets. So I wanted to ask you which one is correct one, because if you calculate by two different formulas, the answer is different. And when I tried to do calculations in the examples, like in tests, so the only correct answer was if I do it by the formula which was provided by you, but not by the individual in YouTube. So
yeah. Okay, that is a mistake on my part then, that I didn't check the video properly. This is the formula you should use. So p divided by 100 times n minus 1 plus 1. That's the way you can find the correct number. And I'm sorry that the video that uses a different formula. I'll erase it and try to find a new one for it. So good thing you asked. But you should follow the formulas. But good thing that you asked. And don't worry too much about it. It's not you're not gonna literally use this in this year. It's more to kind of get a more of a mathematical situation. But as long as you understand the difference and how the formula works, that's most important. But thank you for asking.
Okay, thank you so much for your for this explanation, because I was a little bit confused.
No, that's fine. And if you find that anywhere else, if you think that the video doesn't match with the formulas given on SOISO, then just let me know and I'll try if I can replace the video.
Oh, okay, thank you.
Okay, are there any more? I'll stop sharing my screen. Are there any more questions? Then you can unmute yourself or ask it in the chat. Now is the time. Do you have to learn the formulas by heart for exams? No. The first question was, Annika asked to everyone, do we have to learn the formulas by heart for exams? It kind of depends on which course you're following. There are three faculties who participate in this prep course. So I know, for example, for social sciences, so those of you who study bestuurskunde and politicologie and sociologie, that those masters don't have to learn the formulas by heart. That you get a cheat sheet with the answer, with the formulas on it. Because once again, like I said, it's more important that you understand how the formulas work rather than that you have to know all of them by heart. But I don't know every course from all the masters, like a total of 25 masters participate in this prep course. And I don't know the courses from each single one of them, but I don't think that you will have to know these formulas by heart. I'm pretty sure. Okay, that was the question by Annika. Then the question from Kat to everyone. Hello, I also have a question about calculating the percentile in chapter one via Excel. I receive an error, # num explanation mark, even after checking the epsilon and the comma, and dot is correct. Is there another thing that may be causing an issue? Maybe you can show an example. Yes, I'm very much willing to show an example. It was on the same page as I'll share my screen again. Was it on the same page I just discussed with Elena? So calculating a percentile. Yeah, it was the same page. Okay. I'll share my Excel screen then again. Okay. Share the Excel screen. First, I'll take a look at SOISO to find an example. Let's see. Are you talking about the percentile bracket array comma k formula or not? Yeah, I hate it. I can't share multiple screens at the same. Oh wait, I can. Hopefully, you guys see this now. Is this the part you're struggling with? You can hopefully see my screen. Yes, this formula. Okay. To calculate the 20th percentile in Excel, you may make use of the following function, and then percentile, and then the array, and then k. Array is the array of cell range of numeric values for which you want the percentile value. K is the percentile value in the range, 0 or 1 inclusive. Assuming the sample scores are located in cells A1 through A21, Excel command to calculating the 20th percentile is A1 is percentile A1 to A21. Comma 0.2, which gives the p percent, the 20th percentile is 4. Or you can use the, okay, yeah, using this Excel part, I think that it's a bit, I don't really fancy this way of doing it. I think that it's more important to use the manual calculation. So there are multiple calculations given. So the manual calculation and the Excel calculation, but I do strongly recommend using the manual calculation. And you can enter this formula. So for example, 20 divided by 100 times 21 minus 1 plus 1 equals 5. And then if you look at the fifth number, you can see that it's 4, but I'll show Excel. So it's between brackets, 20 divided by 100 times, and make sure that you have an equal sign in front of it, is 20 divided by 100 times between brackets, 21 minus 1. Plus 1, if I'm correct. And then you get 3. What did I do wrong? I get to a different answer. That's fucking brilliant. I don't know why I'm getting to a different answer.
You said 21 minus 1, but you typed in 10, so maybe that's why.
Oh, that's better. Okay, yes, then you get 5. Thank you for making this. Thank you for correcting me. So in this, if you use this way, the formula, then you get to 5, and then you take a look at the fifth number in the range, which is 4. So you know that the 20th percentile is 4 in this case. And this Excel calculation with the percentile and then array and k, I don't recommend using this one. I think you can use this one if you actually have an Excel sheet full of all the numbers. Then you can select, because it's about selecting certain cells. In this case, it's selecting A1 to A21. So if you would have a whole range of numbers here, then you could select all 21 of them and then use the array function. But since we are working with the exercise in SOISO, you could type out all these. Then you would have to type all of these numbers out over here in Excel beneath each other. And then you could select, then you could use the formula to select the array, which would be A1 until A21. And that's also a way to do it, but I do not recommend it. I think it's not important for now to use this method. I think the manual calculation one is a bit easier to use. So to sum up your question really shortly, why doesn't percentile array, between brackets array comma k work? That because it only works if you have the whole data set in Excel, and we don't. We work with a SOISO example. So that's why you have to use the manual calculation. Did this answer your question? I've been talking for so long that I almost forget. Yes, this formula. Thank you. I'll use the manual. Yeah. And if you then still have problems with the commas and the periods and still get the same issue, then let me know. Then I'll have a private look with you. Okay. Are there any further questions? Now is the time to ask them while others can see as well. Okay, I don't think there are any more questions. Then there's one thing I'm gonna ask from you. I'll also ask it on SOISO, and I'll ask it in the WhatsApp chat. All the master coordinators have asked me to make a frequency table. You should know by now what that is, of how many students from every master participate. So could you text me in WhatsApp in what master you will be participating? And then I'll send the frequencies. I won't mention your name. I'm not gonna, in terms of privacy, I'm not gonna say, for example, that Annika is doing, I'm not texting the market, let's say that Annika is in the marketing master, then I'm not gonna ask, tell the marketing master coordinator, hey, Annika joined my prep course. No, then I'm just gonna say to him, that's actually correct. Okay, that's a perfect guess. Annika actually does do a marketing master, but let's say that, for example, only Annika and Kat are from the marketing master, then I'll tell the master coordinator, there were two students. It's just nice for the study coordinators to know approximately whether only one student of them took place, maybe zero students from certain, like I said, there are 25 masters participating and only 101 participants. So it might be the case that from certain masters, zero people are participating. While if from one master, 20 students participate, that would mean that a certain part of their year would have a head start in terms of statistics, and the master coordinators want to know that. So if you could privately text me which marketing you are doing, which master you are doing, that would be absolutely brilliant. And like I said, I will treat it with the utmost of respect for in terms of privacy. I won't mention your name anywhere. I'm just going to say how many people of every master participate. Okay, then that was going to be it for now. A really short one. And a bit, I'm sorry, it could have been more tight, but I, of course, don't know the questions beforehand. So that's why it might be a bit, my answers have been a bit long dreaded. I don't even know if that's an English word, but that was it for now. Go and work, make test 2 and test 3 before the webinar next week. At least that's what I recommend. And then I'll see you guys for the next webinar next week, Thursday. Ciao, ciao.